A new non-violent mass movement has swept through Pakistan in recent months, demanding an end to Pakistan military's oppression and extrajudicial killings of minority ethnic Pashtuns. This grassroots movement has rattled Pakistan's deep state, primarily the notorious spy agency the Inter-Services Intelligence (ISI). For decades, Pakistan's spy service has operated as a formidable adversary while being dressed as a friend, especially in Afghanistan. It has endlessly frustrated the Afghan war efforts since 2001 by playing Santa Claus to all manner of anti-Afghan militant groups, mainly the Taliban and the Haqqani network. This support has morphed the Afghan conflict into a bloody contest of competing interests and influence, where ISI's toxic influence is supreme. ISI's role in managing several anti-India proxy networks is also unmistakable. ISI is no ordinary intelligence agency. It operates under Pakistan's military command and is highly secretive, politically influential, patient, alarmingly active, and ruthless to anyone they see as opposition. Unlike what some reports suggest, ISI is not a rogue agency but rather a disciplined, non-factional, cohesive, and bureaucratic enterprise where reports of defections are rare. The institution is also well off with its active and retired personnel frequently profiting from numerous Pakistani military-owned charitable foundations and corporations. The agency's nearly 25,000 personnel is mostly ethnically homogeneous, hailing predominantly from the army ranks. More troublingly, the organization operates under a philosophy that it needs enemies to remain relevant and control. This paranoia has allowed the service to manufacture pet militant groups and imaginary threats to drive its motives to do so. The service allegedly maintains a roster of nearly 100,000 militant fighters at its discretion. Inside Pakistan, ISI sits at the core of the Pakistani state. It has regularly challenged the country's civilian rule and has hampered Pakistan's democratic progress through systematic coercive campaigns against dissenting voices, including politicians, activists, academics, and the media. It has forged alliances with extremist religious groups and fringe political parties meant to control the Pakistani people by keeping them subservient to the state. As such, ISI has used old tactics wedded to the new, including intimidation, forced disappearances, arbitrary detentions, torture, and assassinations. The service also frequently engages in sabotage activities, psychological operations, and influence campaigns. More worryingly, ISI infatuation with jihadi groups has adversely affected the agency and has turned segments of the agency increasing in Afghanistan. ISI Afghan operations are undertaken by at least three units. The first is Directorate, the principal covert action arm that directs and oversees the Afghan policy, including militant and terrorist outfits and their operations. The second unit is the Special Service Group SSG, also known as the Pakistani SSNR, the Army Special Forces element that was established in the 1950s as a hedge against the communists. Today, some SSG units effectively operate as ISI paramilitary wing and have fought alongside the Taliban until 2001. In other instances, SSG advisors have allegedly been embedded with Taliban fighters to provide tactical military advice, including on special operations, surveillance, and reconnaissance. In fact, encountering ISI operatives fighting alongside the Taliban in Afghanistan has become a common occurrence that no longer surprises Afghan and American forces. The third ISI unit is the Afghan Logistics Cell, a transport network inside Pakistan facilitated by members of Pakistan Frontier Corps that provide logistical support to the Taliban and their families. This includes space, weapons, vehicles, protection, money, identity cards, and safe passage. Such ISI support networks have been designed to break Afghanistan into pieces and then remold it into a pliant state. The objective is to complicate Afghanistan's security landscape and drive its political climate into an uncharted constitutional territory to create a vacuum which inevitably places the Taliban in the driving seat. These support actions have visibly made the group more effective. However, the Pakistani mantra is that they maintain contacts with the Taliban but exercise no control over them. Yet the ground reality suggests otherwise. The Taliban has recently become deadlier and adaptive. The old Taliban has in effect transformed into a new Taliban, decentralized and sated with recruits, including mid-level commanders who come fresh out of the Pakistani madrasas eager to kill. This new decentralization has enabled the group's young frontline commanders to exercise greater autonomy in the field, allowing IC to leverage them for their needs. IC reportedly managed their leadership succession bypassing the Taliban chain of command. The Taliban devolution of authority has also seemingly fractured the movement unity and cohesion and has resulted in multiple power centers within the movement. The group is increasingly taken over by the Haqqani network, which controls at least 15% of the Taliban manpower and influences many smaller Taliban fronts. Meanwhile, the Taliban leader Habibullah Akhundzada and his principal deputy Sirajuddin Haqqani are allegedly on bad terms, which has also disturbed the movement's unity. The new Taliban's funding now streams not only from the Pakistani intelligence but also from drug trafficking, racketeering, extortion and kidnapping for ransom, where the Haqqanis play a seminal role. Meanwhile, some Taliban groups have taken on to undertaking basic state-like functions, including levying taxes on local businesses, overseeing kangaroo courts, resolving local disputes and operating organized schooling. The Taliban uses such state-like measures to create legitimacy for themselves among the local people. Unsurprisingly, this has formed a tacit social pact between helpless local Afghans and the Taliban bargain, in which the group guarantee no harm to the local people in exchange for their compliance. However, this frail Taliban-civilian relationship exists because of the Taliban intimidation and killing campaign, rather than people's compatibility with the group. More vitally, the Taliban have adopted a robust, resource-efficient operational strategy meant not only to fragment Afghan forces but also to capture more territory. This strategy has enabled the group to determine where and when to fight, in which they skillfully avoid the strongest elements of Afghan forces and instead target where they are weakest. The group frequently employs similar tactics in their operations, such as ambushes, traps, surprise and simultaneous coordinated attacks, and increasingly the use of snipers. At the same time, the group has advised their fighters not to give away information upon capture for up to 48 hours to allow Taliban leaders the time to render any reports useless. Pakistani intelligence has been in many respects in sync with this Taliban strategy. In contrast, Afghan forces are often blind on the battlefield. Simply put, Pakistan IC has turned terrorism into a school of thought, directed from the country-governed spaces that remain undefeated. What can the United States do to unravel the Gordian knot of the Pakistani intelligence and its support to terrorist groups? Three things.